20 copies to
actually, yeah, actually, after this, I'm going to do a book signing right over there. And there are 20 copies of this book right over there. And there are a lot more than 20 of you, so you've got to work out amongst yourselves. But if you go into the dealers room, make a sharp left, Larry Smith's table has them. I do have book flyers. I guess this is the thin version of the book. You're welcome to take this. I guess on the plus side, there are fewer words, so it's easier to read. So I'm happy to take questions, or I'll just do a sign. Yes?
From things like starting with zero pounds, how do you fuel all the way up to the TSA, how do you bring some sanity back to talking about security and how society is going to deal with issues?
Yeah, sanity is hard. A lot of this ties into our fear mechanisms. And the fundamental human fear mechanisms are really deep, really basic, and we're getting better at triggering them. And when you trigger someone's fear mechanism, they can do a lot of things that make no sense in their mind. I think we inject sanity in the debate by injecting sanity in the debate. And that's hard, and it's slow, and I believe for a lot of stuff, like the TSA, it's going to take a generation. My guess is it's 15, 20 years before it goes back. Because it's not going to be the people who felt the fear who are going to say, "We don't need this." There's going to be people who never knew the fear, who just know this is dumb. Now, some stuff is, I think, easier. But I think a lot of it is generational. Now, we are also moving into a lower risk. So our risk tolerance as a species has gotten much lower over millennia. And a lot of that's good. But yeah, I agree. Now, a lot of it has just gone too far. And I think it is just through this fear. So the way to inject sense is inject sense. So I try to do that. You lose more than you win. I mean, let me look at the debate right now over the House passed last week. That's basically fear based. We need to do this, otherwise the internet criminals and terrorists are gonna blow up the world. It's really hard to fight an argument like that. Because it pokes your lizard brain. Cooperation, make the value of defection lower. Right? If there's a surplus of goods, we don't care if people steal them. I mean, if you start stealing air, I'm not going to worry about it. Right? So that does work. I mean, the reason you have to keep doing things is because this is dynamic. It's not a static system. The tapers in their digestive tract are over the course of our lifetime static. Evolutionarily, they're dynamic. So there is this arms race, this red queen race. For human systems, they're dynamic, by years, by months, by hours. So we have to keep iterating the systems, because otherwise the defectors take over. We have so much cooperation that we don't have enough defectors. And because we're human systems, fueled by technological change, we have to keep doing new things. We can never stop, because society never stops. You have no choice but to buy. You could not buy into it, but there will be defectors who refuse to buy into it. There's no such thing as 100% cooperative system. Yes. Neuroscientists and they put people in brain scanners and had them play these games. It's really fascinating. mean, the neat thing about, I mean, to me, about them writing this book is I wanted to think about a dozen academic disciplines. Right? I'm talking about psychology and sociology, but neuroscience and evolutionary biology and game theory and political science and law and anthropology. In a lot of ways, I felt like I was wandering through university, kicking down doors and demanding answers. It was really interesting. And I think it's work that couldn't have been done without the internet. And I remember, and I downloaded about, you know, thousands of papers, you know, literally. And I remember when I had my days in university, these journals weren't just in other floors of the library, they were in other libraries. And the ability to follow a chain. There's entire philosophical literature about the Christian Bible. And wherever it leads, I think we'll bring about a lot more of this kind of work. And I think we are due, our society, for a lot of this sort of stuff, because it's now easier to work in this way. You can find this stuff. But I have a couple of questions that I have to end.
It seems to me that one of the factors of trust is predictability.
Yes.
If you have too much information,
yes,
to understand what's going on, it's hard to predict
what's going on. I trust that you are a will be a bank robber, right? I have ultimate predictability. You are an honest bank, you say, I'm a bank robber, and you're honest about it. Right, so it is predictability, yes, very much so. Especially this low level on intimate trust.
Can you talk a little bit more about the diminishing returns of sort of society enforcing morals versus just expecting everyone to cooperate? How do those decisions get made?
Yeah, it's sort of interesting. It's hard to talk in general about it, but in general, adding more pressure doesn't have a commensurate return in investments. That it might take, you know, 1/10 the effort to get to here, and then, you know, another half the effort to get to here, and another 40% to get to here. You see that in laws. You see that in communities. You know, we can make most of us cooperative through what we do. We can have draconian systems use cooperation, and we can increase the cooperation rate a little bit. Right? So diminishing returns and increased cooperation, also the revenge effects of false alarms. And this is why we hate the TSA, not because they can't catch any terrorists, because they piss off all the innocent people. Right? That's the diminishing return there. I mean, every time they take away your pocket knife, that's a false alarm. I mean, they code it differently because they can't actually produce results on what they're supposed to do is catch the bad guys. They invent these sort of new metrics, which is stopping the bad things. But that's nothing but a false alarm when they take away your pocket knife. Unless you were going to take over the airplane. Right? And you know, the more TSA regulations you get, you know, you're not getting the same value. Double TSA's budget, you're not doubling your security. And take one last question. Way back there. There's a lot in there about in-group versus out-group, accepting versus rejecting dissenters, and group dynamics talks about that to a great degree. And yes, it definitely affects what I'm writing about, but it's not something I research. But there is a lot there. Also, optimal group size. Turns out odd groups are way better than even groups.
Oh, yeah.
When you deal with small numbers, for reasons which actually make little sense to me, that seem to be true. So there's definitely a lot there worth looking at, but it's not stuff I look at. Okay, so thank you.